Everyone's doing well? Okay. Thank you for coming. So for those of you who are new, we have this Heart Sutra series of talks. And you have the text in front of you. But we're only a few words into this text. So for the newcomers, at least I want you to see the whole text, the context. We've spoken about bodhisattva, the meaning of bodhisattva, Avalokiteshvara, and Prajnaparamita, very briefly, but I'll go into that later on during the talk. So tonight, we're going to talk about the five skandhas. The first talk of this series, I spoke about the historical, doctrinal background to the Heart Sutra. And all the talks are, so far, are on YouTube, so you can review them. I spent quite a lot of time when I spoke on Avalokiteshvara about the method of practice, contemplation of sound, of hearing. How many of you have watched those series of talks? Okay, just a few. Okay. Some of you were here, so. So just a kind of background. Now, let me get a sense, because we have several newcomers here. I want to get a sense of your understanding, exposure to Buddhism. So I'll kind of cater the talk to you a little bit. The problem with this, with series, lecture series, is every time the audience is different. So kind of always adjusting. But how many of you have some knowledge, reading, experiential of Mahayana Buddhism? Raise your hand. Okay? All right. No exposure to Mahayana Buddhism. Raise your hand. Okay. Bob, you come here every week. What's going on? You're exposed. We're part of Mahayana Buddhism. Okay. All right. Okay. I'm just going to recap really, really quick. So, there are different forms of Buddhism. Right? Mahayana Buddhism is one main branch of Buddhism under which the whole East Asia, parts of Southeast Asia, Central Asia in pre-modern times, but Central Asia in pre-modern time were greatly impacted by Buddhism. You know, places like Afghanistan, you know, all these different regions actually. Tibet, all of them fall under Mahayana Buddhism in terms of geographics. And then there are other forms of Buddhism. Under Mahayana, there are different sub-branches. Chan, which is the precursor of Zen, would fall under Mahayana Buddhism. Right? And within the Mahayana Buddhist tradition, the Heart Sutra is one of the shortest, condensed, compact text central to the whole development of Mahayana Buddhism. And it centers on the teaching of emptiness. Emptiness. Emptiness is a teaching that further elaborates on earlier Buddhist teaching, non-Mahayana, earlier Buddhist teaching on no self. No self. But whether it's emptiness or the teaching of no self, sounds pessimistic. Right? And that's largely due to the historical and cultural context of India through which these traditions emerged. Where the Buddhist tradition came out of this to be general, religious context of transcendence, liberation, okay, in India. So the language and the cultural understanding are really framed in this language of negativia. So, for example, in Christianity, there's different ways to understand God. Right? In the language of negativia, the negative approach is, God is not this, God is not that, you can't fathom it, right? Just negation, negation, negation. But there's a positive approach, right? Cataphatic approach, right? God is love, right? God is the ground of all being. So, do you get what I'm saying? So in the Indian ancient context, they tend to articulate the path of liberation through this cataphatic language. No self, impermanence, emptiness, you know, things like that. We live in a different cultural, historical context. So it's not the language that's important. It's the meaning. Right? For example, the way I usually articulate about impermanence, all things are impermanent, you could easily understand that as impermanence means new beginnings. Right? Doesn't that sound better? Right? Impermanence just means new beginnings. Right? Things are change, flux. Possibilities. Okay, so don't get too caught up with the language. Emptiness, and you see the text, emptiness everywhere. Not this, not that, you know. It's really about relationships. Same thing with no self. No self, what do you mean no self? I have a personality, I have my history, my understanding, my views about things. Okay. So, another way of articulating that, no self, in the earlier pre-modern context, historical context, is that no self, like this clock. This clock has no self. It doesn't mean personality. Self in Buddhism has a particular meaning. It means independent, separate, permanent existence. So that means there's no clockness to this clock. There's no separate, independent, reified clockness, thingness to this clock. Why? Clock is made up of non-clock. Right? Impermanence articulates this understanding of reality temporally, time. no self, emptiness, understand and articulate this reality spatially. So clock is made up of non-clock. There's plastic, there's some chip inside, there must be a battery. So all these things come together, the invention, all these things from a spatial perspective come together, creates this clock. But there's no fixed clockness to this clock. There's no identity there. Does that make sense? No. Buddhism is not a philosophical tradition only in the sense of kind of analyzing reality. Their primary interest is in alleviating suffering and the causes of suffering. So when they talk about no self, emptiness, they're talking about who we are, the reality of who we are, the causes of our suffering, how to remove those suffering. The reason I talk about that, these two particular angles, impermanence and emptiness. Impermanence would be kind of earlier teaching, generally speaking, although they also use terms like emptiness, but rarely. Right? It's in the Mahayana tradition that really amplified this teaching of emptiness. Right? But anyway, impermanence or emptiness, they're really addressing, you know, keep in mind, addressing the notion of suffering, the cause of suffering. Why is that? Because the way we function, the way we relate to ourselves, others, and the world, and the causes of our suffering is our tendency to reify, to solidify that which is impermanent into something permanent. And that which have, that which do not exist as separate, independent, permanent existence as something, you know, the teaching of emptiness, for example. Relationships. We don't see things really in terms of relationship. We don't think that way for the most part. We don't behave that way. We don't make decisions that way. We make decisions and we think and we feel in terms of this reified notion of me, I, and mine that lies at the center of our experience as if it's permanent, as if it's not empty. Instead of interconnectedness, relationship, we think in terms of separateness. Right? We think in terms of permanence. So impermanence and emptiness are really antidotes to address these deep-seated ways of understanding things. So if you want, you know, don't get caught up with the language. The meaning of impermanence, basically, new beginnings. You can understand it that way. The meaning of emptiness means relationships. Clock is made up of non-clock. So that's kind of the heart of the Buddhist teaching. The Mahayana amplification of this teaching, one representative text is the Heart Sutra. So we're going over different aspects and going into the finer details of this. So we're on the word skandhas. And skandhas is a Sanskrit, Romanized Sanskrit word. It means aggregates. Aggregates. Constituents, heaps, kind of piles of stuff. And early Buddhist teachings, analysis of our tendency to solidify everything into discrete things, including ourselves, is to deconstruct them, particularly human beings, us, into five dimensions, aspects, aggregates, right? Skandhas. It's different than the Cartesian understanding. You know, Descartes, 17th century, articulates this in terms of, you know, body versus mind, material versus spirit, right? Who am I? I think, therefore I am, right? So in this kind of binary way to analyze what a human being is, you know, you can understand the five skandhas as the Buddhist way of analyzing what the human being is. Now, this series of talks is not philosophical. It's practice-oriented. So we're really interested in the meditative contemplation of the teachings so that we gain personal experience so that we can dismantle the suffering and causes of suffering that's wreaking havoc in our lives, right? But before we get to that, we really have to understand what the five skandhas are before we get into the contemplation part, okay? So I'm guessing, you know, I won't finish talking about the five skandhas in this talk. We'll probably continue to 2-3 talks. So this would be part one of the five skandhas. So today's talk, I hope to finish what the five skandhas are. Instead of the binary body versus mind, Buddhist analysis is these five aggregates constituency. And what are the five? Form, sensation, perception or conception, volition, and consciousness. Okay. If you look at the Heart Sutra, it's listed here. In the third paragraph, the way we cut up the text, sensation, or first is form. That's in the second paragraph. Form is not other than emptiness. We'll get to that. In the third paragraph, so also are sensation, perception, volition, consciousness. Right? So that's the five skandhas. Avalokiteshvara is the person who's realizing, engaging in deep contemplation of wisdom, prajna, realizes that the five skandhas are empty. Right? So that's what that is. Now, it seems easy enough, five skandhas, you know, form, sensation, perception, volition, consciousness. Could be an easier way to understand this. But the richness of this teaching is actually very profound. Right? You could say this is the Buddhist phenomenological, epistemological, and psychological understanding. We're talking about BCE time, early deconstructionist approach to understanding phenomena. So form, the first two are relatively easy to understand. Form, it's like the Cartesian understanding of body, right? But the Buddhist understanding of form is very specific. Anything is contactable, obstructable, has appearance. So now we begin to talk about something that could be very subtle. Right? Now, obviously, our body, touchable, obstructable against something else, you know, has a particular appearance. But this subtler definition includes something that's not readily perceptible by our senses. You know, and we'll talk about that. The easiest way to understand this, since we're dealing with our experiential understanding of Buddhism and relevant to our daily life, form in terms of the body refers to, you know, solidity. Fluidity, liquid, things that flow, phlegm, blood, you know, all that. Heat, warmth, right? So a corpse has no heat, right? So it's only relevant for living people engaging meditative practice, right? And wind, or could be said flow, like as in kind of oxygen flow, breath, right, that would constitute like wind. So these four elements are called, you know, earth, water, fire, and wind. The earth would be solidity. It doesn't literally mean earth, or fire, you know, water, wind, but things that are solid. That's relatively easy to understand. But engaging contemplation, what is that which is has solidity? So when a person would contemplate the body as empty, for example, they can focus on one of the four elements, right? For example, solidity of your own body. And then they can extend out to the solidity. They can only amplify and recognize, contemplate the solidity of everything that's contactable, has particular form, right? Like, and then the differentiation between the body, solidity part, the earth element, and that's internal, and the external element of earth, and the difference between that, right? So, four elements, that would be form. So for solidity, a person contemplates this would contemplate the there's many different ways to do it, one of which is the posturing of the body. Like my posturing now is that of seated in meditation. Right? And the sense of weight of the body. Like all of you sitting now, you do feel a sense of weight at the buttocks, maybe, right? Sense of weight, like you hold it. Right? So you have a posturing like this, you have a sense of kind of weight, presence. So the mind will kind of focus on that in order to deeply understand what is this solidity. Right. And the angles to contemplate it is through impermanence and emptiness. It's like the glasses, the filter that we put on to contemplate this. For example, solidity. Where is it? Well, you can say, of course, it's here. I feel it. My body's here. So you observe that. Does it change? Actually, it changes. It's impermanent. How many of you have experienced this? When you of course, your body changes when you're 2 years old to now, the weight, sense of weight changes. But even when your weight is steady, like this year or the past few months, your experience of the sense of presence, sense of weight, actually changes. Like when you are very vexed, a lot of difficulty, trouble, your body just feels like sluggish, heavy. And when you're very pleasant, joyful, you feel lightness of the body. How many of you have experienced that? Yeah. So, what is it? So where is it? Where is this sense of stability? Does it change? Right. Not through intellectualization, but just observation. Embodied experiencing. Right. And the posturing, right? Posturing continued to change. Some of the movements that we have with the body is just involuntary, unconscious. Like you're rocking back and forth, side to side. Did you know that? Or sometimes, you know, scratch the nose, you know, holding here. We don't even know it. Right? Thinking like this, listening to the talk. Right? So one would focus on the posturing as part of this form. That would be one approach. Where is it? What is it? Is there something consistent? Right? How is it experienced? How is it felt? How is it embodied? The body is, you know, these four elements. It's something like a foundation to Buddhist practice. Because most of us, especially us in modern time, we're so disembodied, living in the age of information, technology, where we're bombarded by, you know, images, notions, ideas, different people's sense of truth, realities, different facades, different social media, different sense of self, completely processing that information, we lose sense of the embodied experiencing of our reality. Instead, our reality is mediated through social media, texts, images, words and language of multiple kinds. So modern people are disembodied. Most of the center of gravity is actually here. It's not grounded in earth. It's not grounded in the body. Our sense of reality is here. The TV. You know, when I was growing up, I'm 55. When I was growing up, I think there were like three channels. Right? It's like ABC, CBS, NBC, you know, there's no cell phone, right? And people's experience of their life and is very localized. Their immediate sphere of people, family, friends, school, work. And with the internet, it brings a lot of people together, you know, different parts of the world. But there's a kind of a overabundance of information. And realities. So your reality is not grounded in your localized region of being here. Right? If most of the people spend half of their waking life on the internet, That means half of their reality is mediated by something that's just disembodied. You know, reality means the values that we place, that we have of ourselves, the experience, the meaning that we construct. It's based on artificial intelligence. It's mediated by AI. It's mediated by algorithm. It's mediated by kind of symbolic representational truths. And truth through the internet, everyone has their own truth. There's no truth, right? Everyone has a meaning. Everyone can become like YouTuber, can become celebrity. That's inconceivable when I was growing up. You know, celebrities is a few people. So their realities are completely fragmented. So younger generation of people lose the sense of meaning because they're not grounded regionally anymore, locally. They're not grounded in the relationship, human relationship, in the family, friends, work, school, so on. The reality is up here, you see? And up here, what's up here is completely fragmented. So contemplation of form, of the body, extremely important. Kind of bringing our sense of who we are back down from the clouds into embodied experiencing, as opposed to living the dystopia of, you know, internet. You know. So this direct immediacy of experiencing form becomes very important, especially for our age, to find meaning, to find purpose, to find sense of who we actually are. How does your body actually work under different situations, relating to different realities, to stressors, for example, right? Stressors come, how does the body actually physiologically, corporeally respond? The sense of weight, does it change when you meet a stressor, or you're just very blissfully sitting, lying around, right? And the posturing of the body, you know, how that affects other of the four elements, like breath, for example, wind, earth, water, fire, wind. How does the wind includes gas, like passing gas. All the different elements of wind, right? How does that how is that affected by interaction with the environment? So most people lose touch. I say they're disembodied because they don't know. They don't know how their body works. Right? When stressors come, stimulation come, we don't know that the body becomes tense. We don't even sense it. We're just up here, perceiving difficult people. We categorize as difficult, jerks, you know, so on, stressors, through labeling. And we think the stressors are out there, as opposed to being in tune with how the body. So we have no real method to deal with that. If you think the stressors are out there, it's a never-ending battle, it's hopeless. We automatically place ourselves in a victim mentality. Why? Well, the stressor, my life stressors out there. You can't change what's out there. I'm a victim, that's the culprit. The Buddhist orientation is if you experience that embodied, in an embodied way, the stressor is just a condition. But the tension that I feel, the anger that I feel, is something I can totally change. So the agency becomes here. Right? I'm not a victim. I can actually transform what's happening here. First, I have to expose what's happening, recognize it, embrace it, and then change it. You see? Later on, we talk about different forms of Buddhism. We'll talk about Yogacara form of Buddhism, which says that all reality is a construction of mind. All things are created by the mind. So it doesn't even recognize things out there, which is actually pretty close to the neuroscientific understanding of mind currently. This is thousands of years ago. Why? Because the neuroscientist says that whatever you experience out there is processed through the retina, occipital cortex, provides most of the content. You don't even need too much stimuli out there. Your consciousness bring up all the context through kind of simulation, right? Like, for example, how do you know you're sitting there and someone else is behind you? How is it that you know there's a spatial orientation to where you are now? Like now. How do you know that? You don't have eyes behind your head, but you have a spatial orientation. Why? That context is completely simulated by your brain. Your brain has never lived outside of this dark skull. Never. Never. You have never contacted anyone, including our husbands, our wives, our friends. You have never contacted them. All of your experiences filter through sensory experiences of eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and the brain come to you, synaptic data, neurological firing. It's just data coming in. It's you who are constructing. Oh, this gentleman is wearing a blue shirt. There is no color in reality. There is no color. The color that you see are simulations. You have never contacted the person outside. Right? Well, my daughter did come out from me. How did I've contacted, she came out of me. Right? It doesn't deny reality as in, like, I can touch her. But even the sensory experience of touch, that touch through the nerve endings, come to you through data, synaptic firing of your patterning. So how is it do you actually know you're actually touching your daughter? You don't really know. You just trust it, right? So that's Yogacara. But back to kind of fundamental Buddhism, the more we're up here, the less we lose touch with reality. The more we are embodied experiencing as a foundation to contemplative practice, the more we're in tune with actually how the sense faculties encountering sense objects give rise to cognition and our physiological, corporeal response to that. Understanding the simulations of our experience, the agency is not out there. The culprit is not out there. It's actually here. Then we can talk about transformation, liberation. Right? If the culprit's problem is always out there, there's no need to talk about liberation. You can either be hopeless or you can believe in some creator being is going to take care of things, right? Which is very difficult because our lived experience tells us otherwise. It's not taking care of anything. It's just, it's continuing the problems, right? And in particular, my suffering, my anguish, right? The agency's moved here. How does that relate to no self? Agency? Isn't that a self? is you have to affirm the self, mature the self through spiritual practice, and then we can talk about no self as embodied lived experience. Right? So contemplation of form, the body, becomes very important. It's like the first step. You know, instead of being up here, we're actually experientially coming to know our body and the dynamics between the body, mind, environment, relationship. And then we can actually change it, you know, change our experience, alleviating suffering. See? So form basically talks about earth, water, fire, wind, solidity, fluidity, you know, heat, that's fire, wind would be breath, kind of gas, all the different parts of the body, coming in contact with this. That's what form, that's the simplest sense. But Buddhism also talk about subtle form, subtle form. I'm gonna skip that for now. Like subtle form, like I'll just give you an example, like imperceptible form, like energy. And you can't really touch it, but you kind of feel it. You know? Also, another one would be like karmic imprints. Karmic imprints. Some of the karmic imprints are not only mental, but actually physiological. Right? Imperceptible forms. Okay, that's form. Sensation is also easy to understand. Sensation, Buddhism recognizes three raw sensations, from which multiple variations can come. The raw sensations are pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. No, pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. Some of the finer, more complex sensation, it would be like a mixture of these, you know. In terms of the temporal experience, something could be seemingly, simultaneously pleasant, but also unpleasant, right? I say temporarily, seemingly, because these experiences are impermanent. One moment, one instant, it could be perceived as pleasant. The next instant, it could change to unpleasant, vice versa. You know, like those of you who sit in meditation have experienced something like this. You sit. After a while, you have leg pains. And the leg pains, like right now in this moment, how many of you have leg pains? Okay, all right, make yourself comfortable. Use this analogy to make yourself comfortable, right? So you have leg pains, discomfort, that would be unpleasant. But the curious thing, some of the meditators would know, the curious thing is that if you are concentrated, not distracted by physical discomfort, actually the level of discomfort lessens and the intensity lessens. In other words, there's no real objective reality to pain. It's just a word. Your pain is mediated by your perception. Your suffering is mediated by your perception. And if your mind is concentrated, you may feel the sting, you know, a little bit in the beginning, but you stay at the method of practice, meditation on breath or whatnot. As the mind becomes more concentrated, you can actually forget the pain. Now, objectively, is the pain still there? It's questionable. It's questionable whether it's still there or not. If it's still there, you're just not paying attention to it. You forgot about it. That could be one possibility. Another possibility could be it just vanishes. In that experience of concentration, pain can actually vanish. You know? Sometimes I teach a form of meditation where we contemplate pain, right? Using pain as an object of meditation. Now, it sounds masochistic, but I guarantee you it's not, right? So, on retreat is the intensity of pain. You first relax the body. You adjust your feeling tone, attitude, because what pain inevitably does is exaggerate the present experience. Pain, I'm having pain. You're not actually having pain. It's just one ankle there. Rest of the body is relaxed. Feeling tone, I'm still content. In other words, you're not perceiving threat. So the amygdala in the brain, you know, its job is to constantly look out for problems, right? When it's perceiving threat, it contacts the hippocampus. Okay, send out the stress hormone, the cortisol. We're getting ready to fight or flight. If it doesn't perceive threat, there's no stress hormone. Your body wouldn't tense up. That's just a chemical thing. It's just a physiological. So in other words, you short circuit that defense mechanism. You're relaxed, content. Don't exaggerate. Well, where is it? Well, just one ankle. And the third step is, you know, you isolate. Just one ankle. Fourth step is, you don't label that pain. What is it? I don't know. It's just raw sensations. So first step, relax the body. Second, checking feeling tone. Third, isolate. Where is it? Maybe one ankle and one knee. But comparatively speaking, the ankle is more than the knee, so just one. The knee is manageable, it's just the ankle. Right? And then the next step, you don't label it. We're linguistic beings. As soon as we label something, we reify it and solidify into a thing. And that thing has meaning to us. It's pain. I'm suffering. All kinds of defense mechanism flows out through your consciousness. If you don't know what it is, and you can only do this when you're relaxed and grounded, content. Just moment-to-moment freshness of embodied experiencing. Wordless of that discomfort. Well, actually, you don't know. There's no labeling. So it's just the freshness. The last step is just experiencing. That actually changes the whole game. And the threshold of pain greatly decreases. Your defense mechanism is not activated. So it becomes an object of meditation. So once concentration develops, the notion of pain and the experience of it, one's mind is not bringing the baggage of the past and anticipating the future of, I can't wait the bell to ring so I can change my posture. No past, no future, it's just a freshness. And then concentration develops. Pain vanishes. Provided that your posture is not causing the pain, or you're sitting in a bad posture, or you have some actual injuries. If it's just, you know, regular leg pain, if you have injuries, then you should just deal with it, you know, go to the doctor and so on. You know, so our obsession with pain and the avoidance of pain, modern culture and the industry of medicine, the industry that makes as much money as possible out of our fear of pain. Don't give them that money. You know, is there a need? You have to assess that. We can objectify the body as outside ourselves. The culprit is here, a live body. Actually, the culprit is in the mind. Perception determines the level of suffering. We'll talk about perception next. Right. So sensation could be the raw sensation, pain, pleasant, and neutral. Right. That's the second skandha. Third one is perception. Perception is the function of symbology. How does it use symbols to reify, solidify our experience into different containers? Like, this is pain. Oh, that's pleasant. And this is a friend. That's a jerk. These, what is that? Words and language. Another side of this, the function of symbology, is actually visual, depending on memory of the past, images. So whether it's visual or linguistic, that's what perception is. They're essentially, it's the containers that we have. The containers that we have. This symbolic functioning, you know, such as concepts, ideas, perception along with sensation are two of the of all the mental factors kind of phenomenological typology of what can happen in the mind. That's distinct in the Buddhist analysis. The rest of it are all volition. So the Buddhist analysis in the Mahayana tradition, the Yogacara tradition that I mentioned earlier, that proposed the teaching of all things are constructs of the mind, simulation of the mind, right? That I kind of coupled it with neuroscience. In their analysis, there are 51 different mental factors, and that's just a kind of a rough typology. We have so many more than that. that's not included in that list, but basically there are 51. Excluding sensation and perception, everything of the 51 mental factors. In other words, the 48, 49, sorry, my math is really bad. 49 mental factors are all volition. This includes wholesome mental states, negative mental states, indeterminate mental states like sleep and so on. Right, it's 49. Plus 24 of 24 of the factors not associated with mind. In the Yogacara analysis of things, in the world of human beings, body, mind, environment, including liberation, possibility for freedom, they're altogether 100, what we call dharmas, phenomena, phenomenal realities, 100. 51 of those are mental factors, 24 of those are factors not directly concomitant with mind, such as life force, natural things, words and phrases that have kind of independent existence, and also like deep meditative states. They're kind of outside the mental factors. Anyway, there are 24 of that. So altogether, we're talking about 73 different potential factors that are volition. Now, what is volition? Usually people understand volition as impulse, potential action, intention. But volition are characterized by change and continuity. These two specific qualities, change and continuity. Some of the gross understanding of volition is, volition of body, speech, and mind. Right? Volition of body, speech, and mind. Actions of body, speech, and mind. But some of the subtle ones are really hard to understand. Out of the 100 dharmas from the Yogacara tradition. So body, speech, and mind, in context of the five skandhas, would be something like, I drink this cup of water. I'm drinking form, one of the four elements, water, right? Earth, water, fire, and wind. And the sensation could be three, pleasant, unpleasant, neutral. If I really like water, it's pleasant. And if my context is different, say I'm really thirsty, I haven't drank anything all day, and I drink this water, oh, it's definitely pleasant, So form, sensation, that raw experience, perception would be this symbology, right? Containers that we have. Oh, that's water, H2O. W-A-T-E-R, the language, good, bad, tasty, not so tasty, right? That's perception. That determines my happiness, my well-being, or my suffering. just by that simple to know. Volition is impulse, right? Intention on the basis of perception, on the basis of that, right? So the impulse going, let me get some more of that because it tastes really good. The action of body. Volition, because it's intention, motivation, and karmic propensity, or propensity, action, that's what volition means. This is the juncture in which karma is created. Karma means action. The popular understanding of karma doesn't really mean the Buddhists are like, oh, you have bad karma, this person doesn't have good karma. Karma just means intention. It's like it leaves a karmic imprint on your mental continuum. Right? And that imprint will have effect. So the cause leads you to some effect. Now, if I have a tendency to always chase after that which is pleasant and run away from that which is not so pleasant, like all of us, I'm creating a particular karmic propensity, right? Which becomes habit, which in turn shapes my reality. My perception, even my sensation. You see how this, we only talk about the four skandhas. Right? They look linear. So it's this form, and then I drink it, and pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral. And then I label it, oh, water, oh, it's great, tasty. I have a name for it, tasty. And then karma, volition. Seems linear. But it's actually reciprocal. The very fact that I'm drawn to this water comes from previous impulses, right? Previous inclinations, volitions, previous karmic propensities. Right? If I continue to reify that, always chasing out the pleasant, always running away from unpleasant, then I'm just solidifying, you know, my defense mechanism, you know, my life, and the way I see things, the way I interpret the world, the way I, like everything, which deals with the previous skandhas. You see, what I experience is pleasant, what I think is unpleasant, and the containers that I'm putting down into the world. You see, so it's interlocking. Volition also emerges, also has this function, it emerges simultaneously with sensation and perception. So it's not it's not a separate thing. Okay. So sometimes it emerges, but it could exist by itself. Okay. could exist by itself. For example, in dream. How many of you dream? We all dream, right? Well, check out the images that you dream. It's not really dependent on the sense faculty of your eyes. to the sense organ, to the sense object of what's out there. Your eyes are not functioning. They're closed. You're not using your eyes. So, what's the images in the dream then? And the actions that you're taking in the dream. So it doesn't have to depend on concrete sensations in order to emerge. You're not actually dreaming of a tiger chasing after you. There's no actually a tiger out there, right? You're just dreaming it. Your sense faculty of, you're not actually seeing, the eye is not actually seeing an object. So the volition can, the action, the impulse, can exist independently, functioning. Why is it independent? It can exist independently. That relates to consciousness. I'm going to try to finish this up. The fifth skandha. Consciousness has three basic functions, right? Consciousness is the cognitive discriminatory function. Sense of knowing through discrimination. And the entity of transmigration. So when Buddhists talk about rebirth, you know, so on and so forth, what is it that's being reborn? It's not a soul. It's consciousness. The most subtle form of consciousness. The repository, like this cup, the container, all the karmic imprints of this mental continuum continues. The contents of this container. Now, the contents constantly changes. Let's break this down. Consciousness as a discriminatory function, able to discern differences and stuff, usually arises along with the first five cognitive moments that depend on sense faculty and the sense object. So Buddhism is talking about a tripartite experience, not body versus mind. It's actually body, mind, and environment. It's a tripod. Sense organ, sense object, and the corresponding cognitive moments of consciousness. They talk about eye consciousness, ear, nose, taste, touch, eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and also mind. So all the sense organs, sense objects, giving rise to moment to moment to moment to moment, kind of cognitive consciousnesses. Right. So this fifth skandha, on the one hand, refers to that aspect. You have to have consciousness in order to have experience of eye, ear, nose, tongue, body. Right? So it arises simultaneously along with that, but not necessary. In dream and sleep, and even the person who has mental illness, experiencing hallucination, you know, drug users, LSD, or deep in meditative absorption, where their sensory experiences are not, their reality is not really based on the tactile sensory five organs anymore. For example, my teacher had a student, monastic student, who we didn't know at the time, who had a mental disability. Right? One day he came to another attendant. He says, in the middle of the night, he says, where is the key to the teacher's room? I need to get in there. He says, why do I need the key? Because Shifu's teacher, right? He's dying now. He's dying now? You know, well, I heard a voice telling me that. I need to get in there. We need to save him. Did he hear a voice? I'm sure from his perspective, he heard a voice. Is it based on like reality, like actual sense organ, contacting sense object, sounds, someone talking? No, it's independently created by his mind, his sixth consciousness, his, you know, consciousness. Of course, my teacher wasn't dying at that time. Sometimes meditators experience that. It's quite common. Not even meditators. People that are sleeping. Every night you experience it. Right? So your five senses are not functioning at that moment. Just the consciousness, the sixth sense organ is functioning. The first five lies dormant. REM, sleep. Right? You're having dreams. A tiger is chasing you. I have a student who always used to. Hopefully she's no longer experiencing that. She always dreams. She's at the airport, rushing to a place, and she has too many baggage. You know, it's always not enough time. It's like stressed, kind of. It's not really like a tiger chasing her. It's just stressed, not getting there. She's not experiencing that physically. It's just her mind. Right? So even in sleep, people can simulate a reality. So consciousness. Usually arises dependent on the sense organs, coming in contact, sense object, giving rise to five corresponding sensory moments of consciousness, right? Cognition, we could say. That's number one. Number two, it doesn't have to. Sleep, mental disability, deep meditation states, you know, it can exist independently. You can stand alone. So that's the second one. Third, the previous two, you know, functions all depend on the present life. The third function of consciousness serves as a repository, container. It can't be explained in the present life. It's only understood in the continuity between lifetimes. What actually transpires between lives? It is, what is it that transmigrates between life after life after life, reborn again and again? What is it? Some people have the idea of a soul. Like right now, I'm kind of looking for housing, you know, moving. So some people think of, like, well, the houses can change, but I'm not changing. I'm just looking for different houses to live. That's the wrong idea. That's not the Buddhist idea. The Buddhist idea is that this mental continuum, there's nothing that's fixed, permanent, independent, and separate. Consciousness as a repository, the contents, is just this mental continuum, seeds. What are the seeds? Seeds is a metaphor for the tendencies, that we create, the karmic propensities that we create, that continues. If I'm always chasing pleasure, avoiding suffering, running away from something, not facing reality, then that's the karmic continuum that I create. Right? So it's like an empty container. There is no soul or fixed thing that transmigrates. The container itself continues, this impression continues to change. It's just this continuum. And the sutras talk about it like a flame. The flame. The candle flame. The candle flame, it looks like it's the same flame, doesn't it? You light a candle, it looks just... Actually, the candle flame exists because of non-candle flame. It's empty. And every moment is a new beginning. Why? Candle flame exists because of wick, because of oxygen, because of the wax, and all these things come together and you have a candle flame. But it looks continuous, it's not continuous. So your previous self, former lifetime, it's not really you. Nor can you say it's different than you. It's just this continuity forming the next version. Similar to the candle flame, previous moment looks like you, looks like it's a previous moment, but it's just every moment is a new beginning. Every moment, but it's not unrelated to the previous moment. You know, if there's no wick, there's no previous flame, there's no oxygen, then the flame will extinguish. Right? So moment to moment, continuous. It's like water, waterfall, or stream. It looks like it's the same stream of water, but actually, it's just droplets of water. It looks like a whole sheet, right? But there's no waterness to the water. It just continues. Does that make sense? That's the teaching of no self, right? Or emptiness. So, this third function, the above two are kind of all in the present life. The third function, consciousness, is like a repository. And the Yogacara school, the consciousness-only school, talks about this as the alaya vijnana, which is the eighth consciousness. It's the repository consciousness. It is the most subtle part of our consciousness. That continuum part that gets transmigrated like the droplets of water in the river, like the momentary flame continuing in a burning candle. The most subtle part that gets transmigrated lifetime after lifetime. So it's not really like a person changing clothes in the Vedantic Hindu understanding, like a person changing. The person is the same. Just put on clothes every lifetime different. Or like the analogy that I gave of me trying to find housing, you know, house change, container, architectural change, but actually I'm the same person living in different houses. No. The Buddhist understanding is that the person, there's no, the content to the container continue to change. So, that's called the eighth consciousness. Mahayana Buddhism proposed that. Early Buddhism, they only talk about six consciousnesses. So where did the two other consciousnesses come from? The seventh one and the eighth one is just a more refined explanation, extension out of the six. The seventh one referred to self-referential grasping. The eighth one is the container. Right. So, does that make sense? Yeah. Okay. So these dimensions is what constitute the five skandhas. So form, sensation, perception, volition, consciousness. It's not linear. You could say form and the rest of the four is kind of like mind, body and mind. You could say that. Buddhism is just kind of like a finer division of that. Right? And what is this mind? Well, it has a sensation aspect, perceptual aspect, conceptual, volitional aspect, and this consciousness aspect. Consciousness as cognition that arises with the first five sensory organs, sensory objects, cognitive moments. But it can also independently exist in dreams, in meditative states, or in psychosis, hallucination, all kinds. It can independently exist. And it also has this third function of that which transmigrates between lifetimes. So that's the five skandhas. This is what constitutes a human being. This is what constitutes who we are. Right? And all the different meditative states occur in the context of five skandhas. All of your waking and sleeping states occur within the context of the five skandhas. And liberation, in the traditional Buddhist language, is to be free from the five skandhas. It doesn't mean it exists outside the five skandhas, meaning that the five skandhas can no longer manipulate and shape and give rise within us vexations, greed, hatred, ignorance. So in that sense, free from it. But we can, in the midst of it, and yet free from it. Yeah. Any questions? Okay. Tonight's talk is a little bit conceptual, philosophical. When we get to the meditation, contemplative part, next talk, it'll maybe be more interesting. But for now, what you can do is learn to discern, recognize these five dimensions in your daily life. Just familiarize it. Right? Recognizing what is form. Right? Earth, water, fire, wind. What is sensation? What kind of sensation am I experiencing? How am I subtly categorizing, compartmentalizing my experience, pleasant, unpleasant? Just familiarize that. I'm giving you a little homework. And then perception. Immediately, when you compartmentalize your experience into some containers, recognize that. Recognize it. It doesn't have to be. You're the one putting them in this container. Just recognize. And then the function of consciousness. Also familiarize yourself with that. Maybe not the third function, kind of the lifetime after lifetime, but certainly the first two. Yes. Hi.
I think it's on.
Yeah.
So going back to meditation on pain or meditating during pain, where is that line between non-labeling or not labeling it and avoiding it? Because that, to me, I know a few months ago we had actually talked about this, but it does seem avoidant to me to a degree, and so I'm curious, like, where is that just like a personal exploration thing that one has to do, or is there a line, or am I just not understanding something?
Okay. So the line actually depends on the person. And as practitioners, one of the ability that we cultivate is kind of a ruthless honesty with ourselves, exposing what is actually present and what is absent within us. You have to do that. Otherwise, all of your experiences just hijacked by suppression and chasing after things, you know? So it's this non-judgmental awareness of what is actually present. So that line of, am I just suppressing this? You know? Suppression has a physiological component to it. Whereas contemplation, actually on the method, practicing, that also has a physiological component to it. Right? The difference is when we are suppressing something, the body is actually resistant, it's actually tense, yeah. And we're actually holding on to something. We're actually wanting this moment to be other than what it is. You know, as opposed to just relaxing, availing ourselves to the freshness of this moment. It's a kind of a, experientially, there's a big difference, yeah. For example, someone who's experiencing pain, physical discomfort, it's not caused by the wrong posture, it's not caused by actual injuries that you should be taking care of. It's just, you know, you just sat for a little longer today, right? So your physical pain. And and the person's thinking, you know, wandering thoughts. You know, I want to sit through this because I'm a practitioner. You know, because I want awakening. You know, just I'm gonna plow right through it. I want this moment to be other than what it is. And what I'm gonna do is just all the stages of practicing pain. I'm gonna relax. Yeah, I'm gonna relax. Yeah, I relax. Content. Oh, yeah, I don't care. I don't care about you. Isolate. It's just an ankle. Right? Don't label. I don't know who you are. Is it pain? I don't know. It's just sensation. You know, I'm just going to watch. So what is actually present is this tension. I want awakening. I want to get rid of this. I'm going to get rid of this by contemplating pain. Use that as a method to get rid of that. There's all kinds of things going on. There's a big difference. As opposed to just a person's actually in the moment experiencing, just relaxed, content, no wandering thoughts. You know, there's no wandering thought, calculating what I'm going to do with this pain, and you know, big difference. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Any other question? Yes, please. We have a microphone. Please pass it. There's only one mic. Oh, there's one here. Okay. Yeah. Keep that one on that side and this one on that side. Yeah. Okay, please.
I think I can use a little more help on the judgmental piece.
Yeah.
Because I find myself, I observe people. Well, let's say I was in New York last week. Mm. There was nobody I knew. Mm-hmm. And I'd be in a crowd and I go, oh, you know, compartmentalize that person.
Yeah.
You know, and some of it was negative and some of it was positive. And I don't know that I saw them as enemies, but you know,
yeah.
I would really like to stop doing that.
Yeah. So in our daily life we continually, that's what we actually do. Moment to moment, it's not only that visit that you have in New York City. Moment to moment, we're constantly doing that. You know, we're constantly doing that. We're so entrenched in this activity that we don't even see it. We don't see it. You know, how do we get out of that? That's the content of the next talk. Okay? That's the contemplation part. But generally speaking, we have to first expose the process through which we are judging, discriminating. Right? Expose that. And we have to really face that and accept that before we can talk about transforming that and freeing ourselves from that. So exposing, embracing, transforming, letting go. Embracing, right? Embracing just means recognizing it's me. I'm doing this. And there's a history to why. You know? So we accept it first. You can't really change anything if you don't accept it as part of you. Like, I've been attending a couple of times now, AA meetings. You know what that is? Alcoholic Anonymous. It's awesome. I'm not an alcoholic. I'm just attending it. They have open meetings and closed meetings. You know, open meeting, anyone can attend. Closed meeting is just for, you know, you have to be an alcoholic to attend. The very first thing that they tell themselves when they introduce, "Hi, my name is so-and-so, I'm an alcoholic." And everyone says, "Welcome," you know, blah, 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 so-and-so. You have to recognize it. So it's a kind of empowering. You recognize it's part of you, then you can change it. If you say, you know, it's not me, it's actually the circumstances, how I was brought up, blah, blah, all other people, you can't do it. So true transformation comes when we first recognize it. And the AA meetings are so awesome. I'm giving a little advertisement to AA meetings, but they're so great, you know. So supportive of one another. And we're going to start at the center, hopefully, a Buddhist sobriety group meetings. You know, not AA, a kind of a branch. So we're in contact with the local Tallahassee group, group of Buddhists. So we're going to hold the meetings there. So they have different rules, different steps and all that, but first, really, we have to recognize where we're at, how it has affected us. There's a history to it. And then the agencies here, what we can do to take up responsibility, accountability to change. So embracing is essential. Right? If we constantly think that other people are the problem, the culprit is outside of us, this is the no change. It's just suppressing. That's what you're doing, you know. So exposing, embracing, and then we can talk about transforming. And part of that transformation is learning to train in sense, observing sense faculty and sense object and the what arises, the compartmentalizing, not quite enemy, but you know, difficult person, I don't like this person. What's present? Just learning to suspend judgment and recognizing what is coming up. It's possible. But we do it through sense faculty of eyes and ears first. These are the two sense faculties that give rise to most of our compartmentalization, judgment. So you learn at a more simpler environment, like just observing nature, pleasant things. Oh, flower, oh, dandelion flowers. Oh, I love them. And then just learning in simplified, you know, non-threatening, pleasant situations, that contemplation is called what we call direct contemplation. So we engage in direct contemplation, and then we move on to apply that to more complicated circumstances. It's a real practice, you know, with the eyes. Same thing with the ears, deep listening. It's an actual practice. You have to practice. It's not like you practice meditation, sitting, counting the breath, and then all of a sudden you're going to be able to not judge, you know. So you have to train one sense faculty at a time. So when we sit in meditation, it's basically embodied experiencing of the body faculty. Eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind, right? The body faculty. So you just experience it, like the physical discomfort, the pain. That's contemplation, direct contemplating of sense faculty of the body. Right? Sense faculty of the eye, that's a completely different thing. You have to actually set aside time to actually contemplate. Right? The good thing is once you expose the extent to which we judge, discriminate through the eyes and the ears or the body, the more you're aware of it, the extent to which we do this, the more we're actually freed from it. You know, most people, the problem is they're not aware they're judging people. And then their actions are follow the volition part in the skanda. So form, sensation, perception, they put you in a box. Volition. Right? So the more we expose this, that's kind of a way out already. So even though we can still see ourselves constantly judging, it's better than not being aware of it. Right? Yeah. So just, there are methods to do that. So we talk about that next class. All right. We've gone over time. Some of you need to go. Feel free to leave. The rest of you, we are going to recite the Heart Sutra. We're going to chant the Heart Sutra together. All of you have this with you. Hold the text like this, if you have a copy.
Maha Prajna Paramita Heart Sutra. When the Bodhisattva emptiness not other. is precisely formed, so also are sensation, perception, volition, and consciousness. Shariputra, this voidness of all dharmas is not born, not destroyed, not impure, not pure, does not increase or decrease. In voidness there is no form and no sensation, perception, volition, or consciousness. No ear, no tongue, body, mind, no sight, sound, smell, taste, touch, thought. There is no realm of the eye, all the way up to no realm of mental cognition. There is no ignorance, and there is no ending of ignorance. Due to no aging and death, and no ending of aging and death. There is no suffering, no cause of suffering, no cessation of suffering,
and no path.
There is no wisdom or any attainment with nothing to attain. Sattvas Rilani of Prajnaparamita have no obstructions in their minds, having no obstructions. There is no fear and departing far from confusion and imagining. There is ultimate nirvana, all past, present, and future. Buddhas rely on Prajnaparamita, attain Anuttara Samyak Sambhava. Therefore know that Prajnaparamita is the great mantra of power, the great mantra of wisdom, the supreme mantra,
the unequal
mantra, which is able to remove all sufferings. It is real and not false. Therefore recite the mantra of Prajnaparamita. Gate, gate, para, gate, para, sangate, bodhi.
Thank you.